Jesus has set up his base of operations at Capernaum. Capernaum in the area of Galilee. He's chosen out four disciples at this time in the narrative of Mark. Peter, Andrew, his brother, James, and John. He started a public ministry. He's 30 years in a carpenter shop. Now he's out publicly ministering to people. And his ministry is not like anything the Jews have seen before. It says that he taught with authority. They're astonished at how he taught. He taught as one having authority. Most people quoted rabbis, quoted what a commentator had to say, quoted the opinions of others, and then they gave their message. Like, I'll read commentators, and I'll give you my message. I'll pray about it. But Jesus taught as someone who wrote the scripture already, the word of God. And when you can see that, when you look at the Sermon on the Mount, he taught with authority because he taught with conviction. He stripped away all the things that hid the true meaning of the text or the word of God, all the additions that man added, the Talmud, all these additions that we put on it, the layers that we put on it, and he took the truth out of it. He laid the truth bare. Let me give you a couple examples. An example in the Sermon on the Mount when he said, "You've heard it said of them of old, thou shalt not commit adultery." Well, I'm telling you that if you've looked on a man or a woman with lust, you've already committed adultery. And people are like, that's true. You know, that convicts all of us. We're all guilty. And then he took it a step further and he would say the same thing. He would say, murder. If you've been angry with your brother without cause, you've heard it said of them of old, don't commit murder. But I tell you, I'm saying to you with authority that if you're angry with your brother without cause, you're already guilty of judgment in these matters. So it's telling people that, look, that's the truth. When Jesus talked, the conviction of what he talked with in the Sermon on the Mount, he went to the kernel of the truth, stripped away all man's opinions, and he says, is that true? He forced his listeners to say, is that true? So he spoke with somebody that had authority that made you say, is that true or not? Not this guy said or that guy said, Jesus said. So Jesus is speaking with authority. Jesus said that his words are authoritative. He said, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. Jesus said that. So he's the authority. So when we go to the word of God, we have to understand that this is the word of God. It lives and abides forever. Jesus wrote the word of God. Holy men of God were moved to write the pen and to take the pen out, the quill out, and to write what God told them to write. That didn't come of any private interpretation, the Bible will tell you. Jesus is coming along, telling them the origin of it. He's the author of it, and he's speaking with authority. And you see Jesus in the synagogue at Capernaum, and his presence draws out a demon. That guy's been coming to the synagogue all the time. He's sitting in the synagogue like a normal, regular person. And when Jesus comes in, the demon comes out. What are we to do with thee, Jesus, you son of God? We know who you are, the Holy One of God. You know, it starts to go crazy. And Jesus says, you be muzzled. He tells the demon, be muzzled and come out. And Jesus heals the guy, sets the guy free. And everybody at the synagogue says, man, we've never seen it like this before. This has never happened at church before. And his fame is going out all abroad. So he not only teaches with authority, he goes into the demonic or spiritual realm and he's setting people free. And he can set us free as well too. So he's using his authority to serve mankind. Jesus is serving others. He's not using his authority to bludgeon. A lot of people get authority and it corrupts them. Jesus laid his Philippians 2. He emptied himself. He was equal with God. Thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but he emptied himself and came down here and made himself of no reputation, and he came to serve us. He's using his authority to serve mankind and to lay his life down for us. So he's going to heal people now. So he's restoring mankind to our natural state. It's not natural for anybody to be demon-possessed, is it? No, it's not a natural thing. Jesus came to set us free from that realm of power. You know what? Also, it's not natural to die. Did you know that? We weren't created to die. We die because we're sinners and death came upon all men. Jesus Christ is going to give us eternal life with a new body. That's the whole purpose of why he came. So we have this Jesus speaking with authority, healing with authority, casting out demons with authority, all to prove to mankind that he's the one that should come. Verse 28, we'll jump in. And immediately his fame spread abroad throughout all the region round about Galilee. His fame goes out, no advertising campaign, no leaflets, no flyers. His power and authority is evident. People are getting healed. Real miracles are happening. Real teaching is going on with conviction, and people are drawn to that. Now, some are drawn just for the miracles. They just want to get healed. They know something crazy is happening, so they're come. Others are drawn because they want to hear what Jesus has to say. And I got to warn you, too. A lot of people are drawn to Jesus, a Jesus of their own making. They want Jesus to give them things. Other people are drawn to know Jesus and to know his word and to be his disciple. There's a big difference between a sideshow and a relationship with God. So he's going to rebuke the religious leaders later for saying, you guys are looking for signs. You're wicked and adulterous generation. You're always looking for a sign. And I pray that we're drawn to Jesus, not because of what he does. And he does great things in our lives. He can heal, but he doesn't have to heal. It's his prerogative. We'll learn about that. But he's done many great things. But I'm drawn to Jesus to know Jesus. He's my master. It's like I'm his learner. And the closer I get to Jesus, the more I don't care much about this world, the more I care about my home in heaven, my inheritance that's incorruptible, undefiled, that's not fading away, the things that he's placed in my heart of eternity. All those things become more of a reality. So I want to know Jesus. You know what I mean? I want to know him. I want to get closer to him. So it's not just, it's who he is, not just what he does. Verse 29, so his fame is spreading abroad. People are coming, some for the right reasons, some for the wrong reasons. Verse 29, long day, casting out demons. Church was crazy. Demon jumped up in church, picking out fishermen. And forthwith, when they were come out of the synagogue, so it's the same day, they entered in the house of Simon, Peter, and Andrew. I guess they lived together with James and John. So James and John are with a bunch of fishermen in a house by Galilee. But Simon's wife's mother lay sick of a fever, and they tell him of her. And immediately, or the idea is, they start to say that she's very sick. What's interesting, too, here is that we all know Peter was the first pope, correct? How come Peter was allowed to get married and none of the other popes were? Because Peter has a mother-in-law, and he's not celibate. He has a wife. I'm just saying, don't get mad at me. It's what the Bible says. They take it up with the Pope. Luke would say that his mother-in-law has a great fever. So they tell Jesus about this sickness. And the great thing about Jesus is he doesn't just preach. Like sometimes, like I get home, you can ask my wife, like after two services and everybody talks to me. And I'm like stupid. I'm coming with those when I get home. I'm like, she has to wake me up for prayer. It's time to go pray. I'm like, oh, yeah, okay, let's go pray. Jesus makes house calls. He just doesn't, he's not at church. He doesn't have hours to keep. He makes house calls. He comes to your home. He wants to be with you and among you. He wants to touch your life. And that's a great thing. So he's there and they say, hey, Jesus, a mother-in-law is sick. And he came, verse 31, and he took her by the hand and lifted her up. And immediately the fever left her. As soon as he touched her, the fever was gone. And she ministered unto them. So this is probably one of the greatest miracles in the ministry of Jesus. He Jesus loves mother-in-laws. Amen. That's a good thing. I read this and I'm thinking Peter's in the background saying, you don't have to heal her yet. You don't have to heal her yet. Don't. She'll get better on her own. It's quiet around here now. No, I'm just kidding. They tell her. Evidently, they really love her. They want her to get better because she's a servant. So he touches her. And as you go through Mark, you can't miss the humanity of Jesus. Jesus touches her. Jesus is going to touch a leper here in a minute. Jesus lets prostitutes touch him. You get the idea that Jesus is not just far off, standoffish, like we always think of God as far away. But I think the one thing that Jesus really got into was actually being amongst us, letting us handle him. John would say, we've handled God, the word of truth that we handled. We got to touch. We got to feel God. What a privilege that is. And Jesus came and he was willing. He's not far off God. And the Bible even says one day he's going to wipe away every tear from our eye. He wants to be with us. Emmanuel, God with us. The tabernacle of God will be with men and he will dwell with them. We will be his people. He will be our God. This theme runs throughout the Bible. And I just get this picture of Jesus just so excited to mingle, touch, hug, love people. And I think that's something that we should have in our lives when Jesus touches us. Because we notice as soon as Jesus touches her, what does she do? She gets up right away, no time to recuperate. She's 100% healthy and she starts serving right away. No doubt she's cooking, I guess. I don't know. But she's serving. And that's a natural response. It should be a natural response in anybody's life who's been touched by Jesus. You immediately want to do for others what Christ has done for you, right? If Christ has moved into your life and you've been forgiven, think about all your sin. The moment you get saved, you've been forgiven. How can you withhold forgiveness from anybody else, correct? So when Christ moves into your life, do you forgive the way Christ has forgiven you? Do you love the way Christ has loved you? Those are good questions to ask, because if Jesus has touched your life, you'll immediately love and forgive the way in the amount that you felt that from Christ. And I'll tell you what, there's a load of sin off my record, and I can't hold anything against any of you. I'm saved, I'm forgiven, so I want to live that way for other people. I want to be very forgiving and very loving. Good question you can ask yourself is, if you've been really touched by Jesus, do you love the body of Christ? Do you love others? And are you more forgiving than you were before you got saved? So she gets up and she immediately starts to serve and wait. And I love that. New Christians are like that too, and we should continue that. New Christians get saved, they immediately say, what can I do? I want to help. This is what I do. Let me help. And you know what? That's a natural response of Christ moving into your life. It's a good thing. And this is what she's doing. Verse 32. And in evening time, the sun goes down, so Sabbath is over. The sun did set. They brought, it means the tenses are they continually were bringing unto Jesus all that were diseased and them that were possessed with devils, and all the city was gathered together at the door. So it's the end of the Sabbath day. They find out Jesus is at Pete's house, and Pocono Medical Center empties out, Lehigh Valley empties out, the psychiatric ward's empty out, we're going to Pete's house. You know, Jesus is there. We're out of these dumps, and we're gonna go meet the guy that can help us. So everyone's outside of Pete's house, and it's been a busy day already. And you would think Jesus is like, all right, you know, I need a little break. The whole city shows up. And you know the disciples too, when more people show, the disciples ask Jesus, should we send them all away? Send them away, we can't have them. Jesus never says that. He's always like, no, let them come. You know, he wants them there. So his disciples do that. We do that sometimes, but not Jesus. So they keep bringing people, everybody, all the cities gathered. They kept on bringing them. Verse 34, what does Jesus do? Well, he healed many that were sick of different diseases, and he cast out many devils and suffered not the devils to speak, because they knew who Jesus was. He had that power. They knew he was the Son of God. So he's telling them to be quiet, shut up. We don't need to hear what you have to say, amen? You know. Didn't you do that in your life when you got saved? You shut those weird voices up, like, yeah, go get drunk. Everybody's doing it. That voice doesn't really speak to me anymore. It's more like, you know what? Don't be drunk with wine, where is in excess, but be filled with the Holy Spirit, man. You can do a much better job for the kingdom like that. So it shuts up all those stupid voices, and he heals people. Now, in Matthew it says he heals them all that are brought there. So Jesus is great. He always gets the right diagnosis, right? He knows the difference between disease and demon possession. Most Christians don't. They're like, everything's a demon possession or everything's a natural disease. So some Christians are totally anti-supernatural, and some Christians are totally overboard with the supernatural. Jesus walks up to, I know exactly what's bothering you. Boom, Mom, you're done. You're healed. You know, that was like, get out. I know there's something lurking in there. Get out of there. You know, and they're healed too. So Jesus knows. Now we know Satan can cause physical affliction, but not all sickness is caused by Satan, okay? It's just we get old, we sin, we die. You know, we're corruption. Flesh and blood can't inherit the kingdom of God. We're all going to die. And remember, everybody that Jesus healed died. So the main message of Jesus is, I come to preach. He come to preach the good news that we can be healed eternally, because these carbon machines can't inherit the kingdom of God. Jesus Christ has come to give us life, and that more abundantly. And we need to set our affections on things above, not on things of the earth, where our life is hid there with Christ in God. He's going to come again and take us to be with him in his Father's house. We're going to get a new body fashioned like unto his glorious body. All these promises come through the preaching of the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. Not necessarily getting healed because we pray every time, and Jesus doesn't always heal. So Jesus healed at will, but he didn't heal everybody. You look through the Gospels, and people wonder why we pray. Some people don't get healed, and some people do get healed. In the Gospels, Jesus walked by the pool of Bethesda many times. All these people were sick around it. We don't have any record of him healing anybody, but one day he just walks up to a guy there for 38 years and healed him. So Jesus heals at his pleasure, not at our pleasure. Okay, we can pray. We ask Lord to heal. We want to see. We begged him with some people, young people that get disease or cancer or something. We're like, why, Lord? Why are you doing this to person? You could have gave it to somebody who was 60 or 70. Why this loss, or why this desperation? We pray desperate prayers, and sometimes God says no, and he takes that Christian home to be with him for his purposes, his reasons. But realize this: Jesus is obligated to do one thing that we ask, and that is to save us eternally. So if that person dies and they know Christ, they're going to be with him. They're graduating early. The whole idea is you gotta stop looking at this world as if he doesn't do something miraculous here, something miraculous for eternity inside your heart. And that's the main message, right? So, you know, it's important that we realize that. He's obligated to save everybody that calls upon his name. And one day we're all going to be with Jesus. So the greatest mission of Jesus was to give his life a ransom for many, and shut up demons. Amen. I like that too. So that's his. He breaks the bondage. He shuts them up. He knows what you're sick from. He knows where you're at. He knows your condition. He knows if you're the disease. He knows if you're being harassed by the enemy. He knows all that. Amen. So he's the great physician, right? You know, so it's really good to go to Jesus. You didn't come to me, and I can pray, and I can try to discern. It's much better when Jesus does it for you, right? And you go down, and you pray, and you go, and you open your Bible up, and it's like, this is what I want from you, Matt. This is why you're feeling far away. This is why this is going on in your life. And he speaks to you. It's much better. He breaks the authority, the bondage. He's setting people free. Diseases, devils, he's doing it all. Verse 35, and in the morning, so it's been a long day, I would sleep in. Sunday morning, there's a great slate of NFL games on that day. Jesus could have just slept in. In the morning, rising up a great while before day, this is mean, it's still dark out, he went out and departed into a solitary place and there prayed. So like a ninja, he's tiptoeing, Peter's snoring, and he walks out of the house and he goes away all by himself into a solitary place and he starts to pray. So Jesus prayed. Not too tired to wake up early and pray. The disciples, Jesus had such a dynamic prayer life. They would ask Jesus, Jesus, teach us to pray. Teach us to pray like you do. That prayer life came from praying in a solitary place, praying alone. So it's much more than like sometimes I would like to pray without ceasing. And I just shoot up prayers to God. But the main times that I've been affected by God are when I've hidden away by myself where nobody else knows where I am. And I shut the door and I start to pray. And then God starts talking and I'm really freaked out because I start to cry and I start to say, man, you know, and he starts to talk to me. And he invests things at those times that quite frankly, you can't get in a seminary or anywhere else. You get that when you're with the Lord alone. Spurgeon says, look no man in the face till thou hast seen the face of God. It's a good way to get up every day, right? Can't say that I've done that every morning, but I think I should. Speak with none until you've spoken with the Most High. So if Jesus needed to pray like that, I think we do too. Remember, Jesus got his instructions from that solitary place, from that place of prayer. He said, I don't go anywhere, I don't do anything, I don't say anything unless my Father tells me to go, do, or say it. And he's listening to the Lord all the time. It says, lo, in the volume of the book, I've come to do your will, the will of the Father. Jesus Christ laid his own will aside, and he came to be the vehicle of salvation and to offer his life a ransom for many. And when he was in the flesh on this earth, he lived like the rest of us do. When he was tempted by the devil in the desert, he didn't say, the Son of God, I don't have to be God, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. I don't have to be God to defeat you. All I have to do be is a man filled with the Holy Ghost. So he emptied himself of all his divine authority, still operated in miracles and power, and he could have just smoked everybody, called angels, but he willingly laid all that aside. It's like a guy that's like a master fighter tying both hands behind his back and still winning. You understand what I'm saying? Like knowing he could pull out anything he wanted to, yet he still humbled himself. And it says, lo, in the volume of the book, I've come to do your will. So he acted like one of us. He went to prayer, talked to God in that secret place, got his instructions for the day, wanted to do God's will. You see him struggling with God's will in the Garden of Gethsemane. Isaiah says this. Let me read this for you quickly. Isaiah 50, verse 4. The Lord God hath given me the tongue of the learned, that I should know how to speak a word in season to him that is weary. He wakeneth me morning by morning. He wakeneth mine ear to hear as the learned. It's fascinating. When Jesus gets to Jerusalem and the religious leaders look, they say, how does this man know these things having never learned? The Jews marvel, saying, how knoweth this man letters having never learned? How does he know all this stuff without going to our school? Did he go to your school? No, he didn't go to your school. How does he know everything? Because he's waking up morning by morning, talking to the Father, learning there. He learned in prayer. When he raises Lazarus from the dead, he says, look, Father, I know you're always listening to me, always hearing me. I'm going to pray out loud so these people around me can hear and that they might know that you sent me. Jesus prayed. How important is prayer? I had a question for you. How did you guys get saved? What did you do? So lead me in a prayer. Pray. I need to pray. Tell me, you know, how do I, you humbled yourself, you asked Christ to live in your life, and you said, I want to be your son, your daughter, and I want you to be my Savior. You be my Lord. And then you started a relationship talking to somebody that you thought heard you, correct? Somebody that was real. And that reality, he talked back to you, right? So how can you live your Christian life without talking to your master, right? Try to stay married and not talk to your wife or husband. How long will that last? Sorry, honey, I only got 5 minutes for you later on at 3 o'clock. You're doing good. Great, honey. Have a great day. Okay, goodbye, honey. And never talk to her again all day long. My wife still, communication is key. Amen. Guys, communication. I'm working on that. Sometimes I space out. Pray for me. You don't want to space out when it comes to prayer. Trust me. It's the most important lifeline you have. You know, that was that show. Guy went on a lifeline. Well, you got a lifeline. You can pray. He wakes up early, goes in the solitary place, and he prays. And Simon and they that were with him, they followed after Jesus. Well, really, the word is they literally searched for him. So the guys wake up. They lost the master. They're supposed to be disciples. They're not doing very well discipling right now. They're empty cups. They're just trying to, where we lost our master. We have to go find him. They wake up and they start searching for Jesus. They can't find him. And a disciple's supposed to follow their master, and he's snuck out on them. So they go find him, and they actually find him. And when they had found him, they said unto him, all men are looking for you. So they find him, and they say, everybody's looking for you. Basically, why did you leave? And you get the idea. Peter, Andrew, James, and John want to set up a church at Peter's house, the Church of the Holy Fish, you know what I mean, or something. You know, everybody's coming to Peter's house. We can start it here. This is church. You know, that's how we are. It's like, oh, man, we'll start church right here. We'll camp. You know, they did that in Jerusalem in the book of Acts. God had to send persecution to drive them out, right? So the guys are like, this is awesome. Jesus is healing people. Demons are getting cleansed. We want to set up shop right here. Everybody's searching for you. Come on. You're famous. Popularity's rising. Come on back to the house. Let's keep the service going. Keep the revival going. Jesus is going to tell them what his main mission is and basically what our mission is too. Verse 38. And he said unto them, let us go into the next towns, plural, that I may preach there also, for therefore came I forth. So his ministry was to preach. The word is caruso, to proclaim or to herald. He came forth to proclaim what? The good news. Everybody look at verse 15. The time, this is Jesus' message. The time is fulfilled, it is drawing near, it is approached. The kingdom of God is drawing near, approaching. Repent, metanoia, change your mind, do a 180, think again, run it back, and believe the gospel, the good news. I came to preach the good news, the gospel. That's why he came. What is the good news? What's the good news? Let me give you the bad news first. Bad news is we're all born into sin, and every person in here is going to die, correct? How do I know I'm a sinner? I'm going to die, right? Sin has come upon all men. Everybody dies. Show me somebody that can live forever. I'll show you a sinless person. Jesus would have lived forever if they didn't kill him, and he still lives forever. He rose out of the grave, so you couldn't kill him. He was perfect. He was a sacrifice for sin. So his ministry was to come to preach the good news. Bad news is we all deserve hell. We're all born in sin. We're all going to die. There's no hope for us. You can say, well, I'm better than you. Still doesn't mean nothing. You're still going to die, and you're still a sinner. We're not judging on a curve here. We're judging on the fact that all men die because all have sinned and all deserve death. All have fallen short of the glory of God. There's none righteous, no, not one. Everybody is destined to die. Everybody deserves hell. Everybody is away from God. We have all, like sheep, have gone astray. Nobody seeks God. Nobody wants God. Good news is there is one who's come, who's a man and God, who lived perfectly, never had a bad thought. He could say, you know what? I've never looked on a woman like that. Mm-mm. I've always held them in the regard that God created them. Nope. Never felt like killing somebody. Never felt like doing any murder. He could live his life perfectly so that when he died on that cross, that perfection, his blood could purchase imperfect people like us and give us his righteousness, and he takes away all of our sin. And the good news is you don't have to die in your sins. Now you have Christ, the one who bore your sins. He's given you his righteousness, take away all your sins, risen from the dead and coming back in power and great glory, and he has a kingdom, and you can be included in that based upon his sacrifice for you. That's good news. Good news is you don't have to go to hell. You go to hell because you don't want to go with Jesus. This is simple as that. So that's what do we preach? We preach the good news. People need to know about the good news. They also need to know why it's good news. Many people say, well, why do I need good news? Why do I need to be saved? At the hospital, they used to say that. They used to say, who's chasing you? Somebody going to kill you? Why do you need to be saved? No, I need to be saved from my sins. And that was a hard concept for that to get. Well, people need to realize sin is very important. We got to preach that. People, I don't want to preach sin. It's not going to make people feel their self-esteem. Good. Because when you die, your self-esteem is not going to get you to heaven. No. You're going to stand before God. Well, I got lots of self-esteem. You're going to be like on your face. My self-esteem is gone. Better to lose your self-esteem here and win your soul for eternity. Better to come to God on his terms. So he's preaching the good news. That's why he came. His ministry wasn't to be famous or to set up shop at Pete's house. The miracles and healings are wonderful, but they're not the emphasis. It's proclaiming the gospel. That's the emphasis. That's our emphasis. You'll see Jesus. You won't see Jesus. You'll see Jesus in private prayer in the gospels very rarely. Garden of Gethsemane. You'll see him at the tomb praying out loud for the people's sake. You won't really see him. You'll see him in prayer here, but you won't really hear a lot of it, the high priestly prayer in John. But throughout the Gospels, you'll see Jesus preaching in boats, in synagogues, on mountaintops, everywhere. He's preaching. He's telling people about the good news. So our focus should be on what? The good news, correct? What's your job as a Christian? You're an ambassador for Christ. Your job is to tell people about the good news of Jesus Christ. That's why we're here, too. We got to go into Stroudsburg and spread the good news. Right? So we can't just hide out here and say, Jesus is great. Right. All right. Then we all have our pep rally and then we all go home. Don't tell nobody about it. We're in this world to be salt and light. And he preached in their synagogues throughout all Galilee and he cast out devils. So you still get this idea that Jesus is preaching about eternity and he's taking care of the supernatural realm in eternity. So he's more concerned about the spiritual realm than the physical realm. And I'm glad. Because Jesus can protect me from the enemy, amen? And that's what we want. Now verse 40, a beautiful story, and we'll get to 45. Verse 40 says this, and there came a leper to him, beseeching him, urgently asking him or begging him. And he kneeled down, so he comes down, and he kneels down to him, and he says unto him, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. Thou canst make me clean. And Jesus, moved with compassion, put forth his hand and touched him and said unto him, I will, be thou clean. And as soon as he had spoken, immediately the leprosy departed from him and he was cleansed. Now, leprosy in the ancient world or the first century was a horrifying disease to contract. In Israel, it says in Luke, we know that this man was full of leprosy, so that he had no fingers. His appendages would fall off. Leprosy is so bad that if you get it, it desensitizes you so much you can stub your foot and break your foot. You know what I mean? People still get it today. There are some leper colonies in the world. It's called Hansen's disease now for the scientists that figured it out. He renamed it, but it's always been around. But early Judaism taught that if you got leprosy, that was the finger of God touching your life and he was getting you because you were really bad. You did something bad and you deserved to get this leprosy. Now, leprosy had to be diagnosed by a priest. You had to go to the priest and the priest would look at you. They put you away and they bring you back out and they'd inspect you again. And if you still had the leprosy, at that moment that you were pronounced unclean by that priest, you were sent away. That means you lost your husband, your wife, your kids, your family. You lost your job. You lost your church. You lost everything. And you were sent away from everybody. And you had to put on clothes of mourning and stand 100 feet behind everybody and say, I'm unclean. I'm unclean. And nobody wanted to be near you. You were like subhuman to the rest of the world. People literally threw rocks at these people like they were mangy dogs to get them away. Go away, go away. And they'd run them off. And the only other people you could hang out with were other lepers. That's your only friends. So leprosy in the Bible, it's never healed, it's only cleansed. And the reason why you had to go to a priest and all that was because they looked at it as a type of sin, a picture of sin, like leaven was to them as well. Leprosy in the Bible is always a type of sin, and you have to look at it that way because leprosy itself takes years to develop. It always starts at the coolest part of your body. It starts in your fingers and your toes, and it works its way, and it takes years to develop. And it always goes for the coolest areas first, and it desensitizes. It's the same thing with sin. It eats away. We let it in, and I'm talking about giving the devil a foothold or a sin. Anybody, when you got saved, anybody backslid? Okay, you guys are as holy as the first service. You only got like three of you. All right. Anybody ever sinned since you've been saved? Okay, we can all agree on that. Now, how long did that sin last? 5 minutes, 10 minutes? I call it going AWOL from Jesus. You know, when you first get saved, you can go AWOL for a couple days. You always come back and you feel terrible. Or you can go away AWOL for 5 or 10 minutes in your mind. You can go AWOL from Jesus or backslide. When you let sin or a certain persistent sin into your life and you let it take root there, it starts to desensitize you to the things of God. You don't want to hear about the Bible. I have a quote in my Bible that says, this book will keep you from sin, or sin will keep you from this book. And it is so true. When I'm doing something wrong, and somebody brings out the Bible, I'm like, shut up with that Bible, dude. Get the stuff out of here. You know, because I don't want to hear that, because the truth is going to convict me, and I'm desensitized to it. I'm upset, and I'm angry about something. There's bitterness in my heart. I don't want to hear Jesus tell me to love everybody. Right now, I'm holding a real good grudge, and I don't want to do that right now. And some pompous Christian is going to tell me, you need to love everybody like Christ loves us. And I don't want to hear that right now, because that sin has taken root in my heart at this point. So I don't want to hear that. That's what leprosy does. See, bitterness, the Bible talks about bitterness as a root of bitterness. It can defile a lot of people. And we think, oh, well, sin is just drinking or took. That's sin, but root of bitterness is dangerous. You can't get that out. You can't love anybody if you're bitter. And Christ is love. So if we let that in our lives, it starts to desensitize us. Guess what we start to do? We start not reading our Bible. We start not praying anymore. We start not doing the things that we know Christ wants us to do that makes us feel closer to Christ. So you feel unclean. Now, when I feel unclean, you know, you feel like God can't forgive you. The disease has spread too far. You start to be contagious. Did you ever meet somebody who's angry? All right, I'll give you an example for me because I know you're all perfect. I get cranky sometimes, very rarely. It happens once, twice a week, maybe. Get cranky, right? I don't want to do something, or somebody's pushing me, you know, and I'm like, and Sharon will come to me, and she's very sweet. I'm like, and she'll say, don't be cranky with me, and she'll start, like, my Holy Spirit, you know, like, right on me. I'm contagious. What I'm doing is I'm spreading my disease to her, is what I'm doing. I'm hurting myself and others, so. And thing about sin, too, I got to tell you, too, it will isolate you. When I was in the world, right, it was real fun in games first. All my buddies were getting high. And then the progressiveness of sin got to the point where I'm all by myself. And I'm alone. And I'm contagious. And nobody wants to touch me. I'm a pariah to my family. I'm a pariah to the people around me. I have let this into my life. Now stuff's falling off of me. I smell 100 feet away. Everybody knows what I'm up to. I can't hide it anymore because I stink with it. That's the idea of this leprosy. This man, this leper, he pushes through the crowd. And no doubt it parted like the Red Sea, because here comes a leper. It's like, they all part this way. But there's only one man still standing, and that's Jesus. He's not afraid of the leper. He's not afraid of catching his disease. He wants to meet this man, and he wants to actually touch this man. And there's only one man who stood his ground, and that's Jesus. And I pray that that was the same for you when you got saved. The only person who stood his ground in my life was Jesus. People ran, friends ran, churches can run, but Jesus will remain. If there's something real between you and Jesus, he wants to touch your life. He wants to heal the leprosy is the idea here. There was only one man who stood his ground. So you got to realize the synagogue had kicked him out. His family had kicked him out. His job, everybody rejected him. He was subhuman to the rest of the world. You have ultra pure Jesus, meaning an ultra diseased person. What does Jesus do? Does he throw rocks? Does he run away? Get away from me, you're unclean? No. He reaches out and he touches him. The man kneels down and says, if you will, you can do this. If you will, you can make me clean. And I came to Jesus like that. This story always means something to me because it reminds me of when I got saved, you know? Nobody else wants me, you know what I mean, at this point. I've ruined so much of my life. Do you want me? Do you really want me? Are all these stories true that you do love me despite my sin? Will you have me? And Jesus reached out and said, I will. I will. And he wants you. He wants each person in this room, no matter where you've been, what you've done, what depths of sin you've participated in. And I'm sure we could get some stories out of you guys. But if you've met Christ, now you're saved, you're washed, you're cleansed, you're just brand new. All your sins are sent away. I've gotten to the point, this man says, where no one else cares, will you care for me? And I love the response of Jesus. I'm willing. I'm willing, and to prove it, he touches him. Now, how long has this man not been touched? He's a leper. Now, human touch is important. I don't care what anybody says. You hug, you shake hands. Human people, they need that sense of feeling, that togetherness. Family needs that. So how long had it been since somebody had touched this man or gave this man any type of feeling? He couldn't feel anything anyway. How long had it been? Well, Jesus didn't just heal him. He loved him. He owned him. The finger of God. Well, if the finger of God was getting him, Jesus' finger was stronger. He's saying, this is the real finger of God. This is the real finger of God. I'm going to set this man free. I'm going to make him whole again. Now, when he touched him, you got to realize he's immediately cleansed. That means his fingers all popped on. His nose popped back on. His ears popped back on. He's like fresh pink skin like the day he was born. Whatever Jewish tan skin he had. Boop, he's back like that again, right away. 100% whole again. Immediately, he was cleansed. He was cleansed. He was cured. Fingers and toes come back. That's a great lesson, too, for us. Now, I look at our world, and don't you see, what do we do with our lepers? You know, and there's lots of lepers. We have psychiatric hospitals. We can't figure out stuff with people. We throw them in a psychiatric hospital. We throw them in the hospital. Put them in jail. Put them all in jail. Throw them in jail. We throw them all in jail. Jailing's a big industry that we have. Nursing homes, you know, dad's getting too old. When I get old, please do me a favor. I'm not into, let me stay at your house, somebody. My kids won't. I want to be in a home. I want to hear people talking, and I want to hear, like, you know, stuff happening. Food cooking and people running around, kids getting yelled at, dogs running in and out. I like that stuff. Don't put me in no room with a little blue screen and, like, okay, die. Doesn't that scare you? I don't want to do that. People are like, you can stay at my house, you know. The world can only segregate lepers. You understand what I'm saying? And the sad thing, too, the church does it, too. We tell whole communities, we don't want you. Jesus wants them. Amen. You know, we look at communities that are, and they may be living in lifestyles of sin. I'm not condoning any sin. I want you to understand that Jesus Christ died to save us from our sins, right? And those things Christ set me free from, right? But if nobody would have reached down into my mullet-wearing, drug addict-taking self, I wouldn't have came to Christ. But when I heard this message, well, Christ loves lepers, well, he can love me too. And he can touch them, and that's our message. That's the good news. That's the gospel. He said, I came to preach it in these towns, and here comes this man. The synagogue separated them, world separates them, and they get rid of them, but Jesus Christ takes them and he cleanses them. He doesn't just take them out of their sin or leprosy. He cleanses them, he owns them, he loves them. Only Jesus can do that. You can come to me all you want. Only Jesus can cleanse you. He's the one you need to go to be born again and fresh and have a new start. Verse 43. Now, this is funny because he straightly charged him and forthwith sent him away. So you get saved. He's leprous cleansed. He's shocked. He's amazed. Now he can be around people. And he says unto him, you don't say anything to any man, but go thy way. Show thyself to the priest and offer for thy cleansing those things which Moses commanded for a testimony unto them. So the first thing he says is don't tell anyone, which is very difficult. He wants him to go to the priest, and he wants him to offer the sacrifices that are in Moses, so it would be a testimony to the priest, Annas and Caiaphas, down at the temple, a testimony to them. A testimony to them that lepers are being cleansed. Now, the priests, they knew how to diagnose it, but as far as we know, no priest had ever offered the sacrifice for a cleansing. Leviticus 14 is a whole chapter on the day of the leper, the offering on the day the leper gets cleansed, and the whole chapter tells you about it. But in the history of the nation of Israel, we only have Naaman the Syrian, after the law is given, getting healed or cleansed from leprosy when he's dipped in the Jordan River during the days of Elijah. We don't have any other person in Israel ever getting cleansed in the Bible record, except for Miriam, and hers was before the law. So as far as we know, no one was ever cleansed. See, all the priest could do at that time was diagnose you. And that's all I can do. You come to me for counseling, I'm going to diagnose you and say, man, you got lots of leprosy. This is falling off, that's falling off, this is falling off. You got lots of leprosy. Lots of things going on. You need to be cleansed. That's what I'll tell them. You need to go to Jesus. You need to get cleansed. And that's where your life will change. And that's where you'll get new affections and new desires when Christ moves in. The Jewish priest never offered the sacrifice for the cleansing of a leper. Like I said, a whole chapter is dedicated to it. So that means that God wrote chapter 14 for Ananias and Caiaphas in Leviticus. He wrote that just for them, just for this time, so that they would know when the leper... See, this is not the only leper Jesus is going to send to the temple. He's going to send streams of them to the temple. And they're all going to go to the temple. And we used to be a leper. Remember me? Is that you? Yeah, that's me. You kicked me out a long time ago. I'm back. I'm here to offer my sacrifice, the sacrifice in Leviticus 14. I've been cleansed. Who cleansed you? Jesus. The Messiah is here. That was the message they were supposed to get. Well, what was the sacrifice? You take two doves. You take one earthen vessel. You fill it with living water. You run it over water. You kill the one dove. You let the water, you let the blood flow into the living vessel till it's red. Then you take scarlet, cedar, and hyssop. What did David say? Cleanse me with scarlet and hyssop and I shall be clean. David understood this sacrifice, and although it was never offered. And you dip the scarlet, the cedar, and hyssop in the water, and you sprinkle it on the man seven times. You take the other dove, you dip it in the bloody water, and you set that dove free. A picture of Christ dying and us being set free. You imagine them dusting this thing off. What do we do? What do we do? You know, this is what we do. What a testimony. Then the priests take the man. They put him away. They bring him back out. If the leprosy is still gone, they take two lambs. They sacrifice one. And the other one's a trespass offering. And they take the blood of that lamb. And they put the blood on his right ear for what he hears. The blood of Jesus covers that. His right thumb, where he goes, his hand, what he touches. And the big toe of his right foot, where he walks. Then they take oil and they put it on the same places. What he's going to hear now is going to come from God. It's going to be anointed by God. Where his hand goes is going to be anointed by God. Where his foot walks is going to be anointed by the Spirit of God. It's a picture of salvation. It's a picture of Christ. That's why he waited all that time to pull that out on them. That's how we get saved. The blood gets applied to our lives. Habits start to change. The Spirit of God motivates us to walk in different directions. And he's sending the lepers back in streams, and the priests are offering the sacrifices. That tells me that God loves Annas and Caiaphas. He wrote a whole chapter for them in the Bible. Jesus, how'd you get healed? Jesus touched me. So he sends this guy away, and that's what he's doing. Now, I got a question for you. Has Jesus touched you? Is the blood applied? Is the oil in your life? Important concepts. Verse 45. But now this is when we don't listen to Jesus. He gets saved, and what does he do? He went out and began to publish it much. So we got a one guy in the whole area of Galilee. We got a whole church. If everybody in this church was like this one guy, the field would be filled with people getting saved. And he began to blaze it abroad. It means what it means. It means like a wildfire. And he's like a wildfire, one guy evangelist, and he blazes it abroad. Jesus told him, don't tell anybody, and he tells everybody. Jesus tells us to tell everybody, and we don't tell anybody. I don't get it. Insomuch that Jesus, like, he did it so much that Jesus couldn't even get into the city because everybody's like, did Jesus, that's Jesus. Yeah, that's him, and everybody's attacking Jesus. So Jesus has to hang out in the desert. He wants to go be with people and touch people's lives, but he can't because there's too much of a mob created by this guy who he told not to tell anybody, and he told everybody. It's the moral of the story. He was without a desert place, and they came to him from every quarter. So he can't help himself. He's been healed. He finally gets to be around people. No doubt he hasn't talked, had many good conversations. Let me tell you what happened. And he has his story memorized, and he's telling every single person he sees, you know, and pretty soon the whole town hears about it. He tells everyone. And I kind of get the idea. Why can't we just obey Jesus? Jesus knows better. And he's like, you know, sometimes our zeal can get in the way of ministry, can't it? Like our zeal. When I first got saved, I was called Matthew the Zealot. Even my own Christian family didn't want to be around me. The Christians, I annoyed the Christians in my own family. That's how crazy I was. Praise God, he gave me an outlet with preaching. They call me Matthew the Zealot. That's kind of like this guy's. Man, you should have seen me. I was a leper. Remember me? Yeah. Oh, man, you had it bad. Yeah, I had it real bad. Now look at me. I'm cleansed. Jesus did it. You know what I mean? Jesus told him not to tell anybody. So this guy was no doubt well-intentioned, but Jesus couldn't even get into the city anymore, and the people came out to him. So sometimes our zeal can get in the way. It's best just to obey Jesus when it comes to ministry, isn't it? I see churches that don't obey Jesus based on basic biblical principles. You know what they are? Singing songs and spiritual hymns to one another. The word of God has to be taught, and prayer. Three things. We don't need interpretive dance. We don't need smoke. We don't need helicopter drops. We don't need the latest greatest. I like a good band every now and again, so don't get mad at me if I bring one in. We don't need the latest and greatest. What we need is prayer. We need the word of God. We need the spirit of God. And we need to praise God. It's simple. The modern churches like to improve on just obeying Jesus. But this guy didn't listen, and he blazed it abroad, and everybody heard about it, so that Jesus couldn't come into the city anymore. But the amazing thing is that Jesus loves lepers, right? And Jesus cleanses lepers. And this man had a story to tell. He blazed it abroad. We have a privilege. I have a privilege. Every week when I get up here, now I know you've probably heard my testimony ad nauseum, but you've got the same testimony of Christ has touched your life. You are told by Jesus to blaze it abroad. And I want to do that more. I don't know about you guys. I have a feeling you want to do the same, right? The question, do you want to see everybody that you know come to know Jesus? Has he touched your life? He's touched my life. And he's given us the privilege of blazing that message along. And a great part of that message is that he's willing. Amen? He's willing to love on us. The men can come. He's willing to take a leper, and he's willing to cleanse them. He's willing to take a prostitute, and he's willing to forgive her. He's willing to take you and me and make us sons and daughters of the Most High God. What an amazing message we have. Our lives should reflect it. Let's stand. We'll pray. We'll ask the Spirit to fill us. Put it in our ear, in our thumb, and our foot. And Father, Lord, what we hear, Lord, may it come from you, Lord, not from the voices of this world. Lord, shut them up, Lord, so that we can hear you clearly. Lord, muzzle them so that our ears can hear, Lord, and you can waken us morning by morning. You can give us the tongue of the learned, Lord. You can give us the words to say to people that need to hear it, Lord. And we can connect with you, Lord, that our hand might find the things that you want us to do and our feet might walk in your paths, Father God. Lord, we know that the blood is on the doorpost of our lives, Lord, and we know that when we die, Lord, you've covered our sin, and you've got a place for us reserved, undefiled, that fades not away in heaven for each one of us. And we're grateful for those things, Lord. Help us to grow in that grace, Lord Jesus, and to love others the way you love them, Lord. I pray for all the people that are out there, Lord, that are separated, Lord, that are segregated, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you'd send them here in streams and that we might have the capacity to love them. Lord, we want to be a church after your very heart, Lord. Thank you for finding this leper and making me your son. Lord, use me, I pray, for your kingdom. Help me to blaze it abroad, Lord, I pray in your name. Amen.